Well, I would say to my friends in the Evangelical Theological Society that we recognize that the issue of theistic evolution is focused on Genesis 1 to 3 and the question of whether these chapters should be understood to be historical narrative, reporting events that actually happened. We argue in this book that it is not to be taken as poetry, it should not be taken as allegory. It's not a story of archetypal everyman that just represents the truthfulness about the human race rather than about specific individuals, Adam and Eve. We're saying that Genesis 1 to 3 is not ancient Near Eastern myth with no attempt to report actual events. We're saying it's not a creative retelling of Israel's history, rather that it is trustworthy historical narrative, anchoring the subsequent history of the entire Old Testament and confirmed as historically truthful and reliable by 10 different New Testament books. I would say it's important to reject the theory of theistic evolution because it really threatens the truthfulness of the Bible. I think if we deny the historicity of the narrative about Adam and Eve in Genesis 1 to 3, we're denying the inerrancy of Scripture. And that's not all that's at stake. These first three chapters of the Bible are tremendously important because these chapters provide the historical foundation for the rest of the Bible and for the entirety of the Christian faith. That means that the debate about theistic evolution is also about the validity of several major Christian doctrines for which these three chapters are foundational. Because if we think for a minute, in Genesis 1 to 3, Scripture teaches us essential truths about the activity of God in creation, the origin of the universe, the creation of plants and animals on the earth, the origin and unity of the human race, the creation of manhood and womanhood, the origin of marriage, and the origin of human sin and human death, and man's need for redemption from sin. Without the foundation laid down in these three chapters, the rest of the Bible would make no sense, and many of those doctrines would be undermined or lost. So I think it's no exaggeration to say that these three chapters are essential to the rest of the Bible. It's important to recognize what is actually happening in the debate over theistic evolution. Our friends who hold to theistic evolution are claiming, in essence, that there are whole areas of human knowledge about which they will not allow the Bible to speak with authority. They will allow the Bible to speak to us about salvation, about miracles, about the life and death and resurrection of Christ, but they won't allow the Bible to speak to us about the origin of all living things on the earth, about the origin of human beings, about the origin of moral evil in the human race, and the origin of human death, and the origin of natural evil in the world, and the perfection of the natural world as God originally created it. And even to speak to us about the nature of Christ's own personal involvement as the creator of all things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, Colossians 1:16. Now, these are massive areas of human knowledge. They affect our outlook on our entire lives. Yet theistic evolution has decreed that the Bible cannot authoritatively speak to us about these areas of human knowledge. These topics, they say, are the exclusive domain of modern naturalistic scientists, and they're off limits for God to speak to us about. But do Christians today really want to accept a theory that decrees that God is not allowed to speak to us about these entire vast areas of human knowledge? Finally, there's another question for Christian leaders. If theistic evolution requires a denial of so much of the historicity of Genesis 1 to 3, is it really an acceptable position for people entrusted with leadership and teaching responsibilities in churches and parachurch organizations today?